week's Dear ABG, the place and space where we answer your questions. We also run a podcast called Asian Boss Girl. My name is Janet.
I'm Mel.
I'm Helen.
And that's a random guy.
Poor girl.
Doing random construction up in the bathroom upstairs.
Yes.
Before we get into your questions, we're going to ask each other a question that we have found randomly. What is the grossest sounding English word?
Okay, I think a lot of people say the word moist is gross. You kind of like it?
I kind of like that word because I think of moist like cake.
Oh, how about moist panties?
Yeah, okay, gross.
Moist boxers, ew!
Ew!
I also think the word that Simu used in our episode with him, he used the word troglodyte.
Bad word.
And that is a nasty sounding word.
When I hear the word troglodyte, I think of like a snout, like someone's, like a pig snout, like looking around for stuff. Because trog sounds like hog. Yeah, I didn't like that word
either.
That's
a fair association.
Okay, I have two words. I don't know why, I've always thought the word fart is just not a cute word. Like fart, it doesn't sound cute, it's just like, ugh. Fart.
Yeah.
The other word, engorge.
Oh,
it just sounds gross, right?
Sounds kinda hot.
Ew.
So the word that turns her off turns her on, and vice versa.
I'm just kidding. Helen gave me the. It's like
my love for you is engorged. Is that the right way to use it?
I think like an overstuffed sausage or like a very swollen finger.
Swollen finger,
right?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
What's your word, Janet?
I actually think the word gross is kind of gross. I don't really like that word. But also the word pus.
Oh, yeah.
I think you get like visuals.
Yeah.
I think any word where it's like secrete.
Yeah. Like liquidy stuff coming out of somewhere. I don't know. We don't need that.
All right, so our first question is from Vanessa from San Francisco. She asks, what is in your purse or bag right now? And what essentials do you always keep on hand and why? I think all of us have our bags on standby. So let's go get our bags.
Okay.
All right, Helen, why don't you go first?
Okay, so this is one, my Longchamp bag, and I've had this bag for such a long period of time. This is a very good work bag, not sponsored, but the most sturdy, and it feels waterproof. But what do I have in here? I always have my keys, the essentials, my credit cards, gum, and my AirPods, my laptop, external cord, and an external battery. I also have Pepsid.
That's my always have that.
Yeah, not one bottle.
Oh,
not two. You just never know.
Prepared.
This one's full. That one, there's three left in this. Oh, and lastly, I love this thing. This is on my bag, not in my bag, but this little clip thing has saved my bag from touching the ground in a lot of dirty areas. So you can hang this forever. That's like, this is one of my favorite little tools.
It's very functional.
Very convenient.
Yeah.
This is my bag. This is actually a faux leather bag. I looked up specifically a vegan purse brand. So this was my work bag that I usually use. I only have two.
Yo,
bags.
This girl is minimal.
There's nothing here.
I put everything in there in a bag as much as I can. So there's like not loose items. So it's wallet with all the wallet things that you would expect. And then this is my like catch all of everything bag. So sometimes when I just take this bag, I have like some credit card and ID in here. I have my earphones, extra contact lenses. Anyone who wears contacts knows that you need spares. I also, because it's in the time of COVID, have
condom.
I have a rubber glove for when I go to the gas station because you don't want to touch the like handle things because that's like it's a place where a lot of things are being contracted. But yeah, that's pretty much it.
Very nice. Well, I looked very hard for this bag. It's the ABG totes that I honestly rock because I love our totes. So this is our line of bags. I always have, wallet. I have a bag with all my tampons and, panty liners because ladies, you never know when you're going to leak and your time comes. I also have hand sanitizer because I think obviously in our current world state, it's always good to be clean. I have a box of eyelashes that my friend gave me. I have deodorant now because I feel like we've been filming a lot. I sweat a lot. And I have a Panda Express gift card that I have $3 left on I want to use. Yeah, that's
very
all.
Nice.
That's all I have in here. In the ABG tote at AsianBossGirl.
Dot my Shopify.com.
And then my Shopify. MyShopify.com.
All right, so for our next question, it comes from Elena. She is from New Jersey, East Coast, what up? She says, hey girls, huge fan of Dear ABG. So recently I met a guy on a dating app, and personality-wise and values and viewpoints, we think the same and everything is perfect. But I'm not physically attracted to him. I hate to admit, but he's not my type physically and looks-wise, and I don't need to be shallow because I do like everything about him. But how important do you guys think physical attraction is in a potential relationship? Do you guys think it could grow over time?
This is a really good question, mm-hmm. and I think that it's something that I still grapple with. But first, I would say it is not shallow to care about physical attraction. I think that's actually an essential part of finding a partner. However, I do think it can develop. However, never to the same level as if it's there initially in the first place. Mm-hmm. So I think it's up to you to decide, because it's different for every person, like how much you value physical attraction over the other things in a relationship. So it's kind of, I think, by person. Mm-hmm. It can develop, but that's my take. What about you, ladies?
Okay, in terms of your question about growing over time, I think if you're attracted to their personality, then their physical appearance does like grow on you over time as well. But what you mentioned about how this guy checks off all the boxes in personality and values, is he perfect in that way that he checks off all the boxes, or do you actually feel like chemistry with your personality? Mm-hmm. Because I do think if someone were to check the box and that's perfect, but there's no chemistry within like your conversations and your personality in general, I think it's not gonna work out in the end. It's not gonna be a long-term connection. What do you think?
So for me, I think it can happen. I've gone out with someone, boyfriend, girlfriend, where initially we started off as friends and I didn't find him attractive. But the more that we hung out, his personality was just so amazing, mm-hmm. and he made me laugh so easily. Everything about him was amazing. And eventually I started to see him in this like very hot, like light, like a mm-hmm. like a spicy light, you know? Not like a right now where we're sweating. But I think it can happen. I do think it's a little bit harder though if it's someone on the dating apps, because you're not gonna have that time to really curate mm-hmm. this like friendship beforehand for his maybe personality to shine. I do think it's possible though, maybe if you want to give this more of like a long-term situation and be friends first. But yeah, like Janet says, you gotta want to jump him too, mm. right? Especially if you're like going into it knowing that you want to date them. Mm. I don't know, that one's hard.
Our next question comes through the form of a voicemail, so we're gonna play that right now.
Hi ladies, my name's Simon and I'm from Boston. I've been listening for a while now and really enjoy the stuff you guys put out. Boston. It's really relatable and helpful content. I think it's super cool because Helen is from Boston and works in finance, which is basically my background. To get into things, ever since graduating, I felt very lost and not knowing what my purpose is. It's kind of hard to talk about or figure out because I'm always telling myself I don't have a reason to complain, in the sense that I have great things going on for me. I did well in school. I was involved very well in college as the president of my Asian interest fraternity. I got a well-paying job in finance. And it all sounds great, but I feel very lost as if there's no meaning to any of that. Kind of like I just checked the boxes of Asian American success. I'm trying to learn to be happy and grateful for what I have now, because I know I'm very fortunate for the things that are going on for me. But is there any recommendations or guidance you guys might have? Is this something you guys have gone through? Thank you for listening.
Hi Simon, I may have not worked in finance before, but I understand the feeling of working in a corporate job and feeling unfulfilled and feeling as if what's the purpose and why am I here? I think when I'm in those situations, I ask myself two questions. One is it the role that I'm not fulfilled in? Do I need to change departments? Because for me, with my last corporate job, once I switched departments, I actually felt much more fulfilled because I was challenged in skills that I wanted to learn versus feel like I was just doing things. Another question I would ask is like, what activities or community orgs were you really excited about in college? And can you find that community again in your adult life? Like, I think for me, when I was working corporate, the fact that I had my Asian American group of creatives really helped me kind of feel fulfilled outside of work, and that's how the podcast came about. I think being surrounded by, you know, Asian Americans who are also creatives like really motivated me and pushed me. So try to find your community outside of work as well.
No, I think that's really good advice, Mel. I would say that if you're already feeling this way, to really try and lean into that feeling rather than running away from it. Mm-hmm. Because I think if you do ignore it, it's gonna come out in other toxic ways, whether it's like anger towards like your mm-hmm. friendship or your families, or it might be like in the form of substance abuse or some other way where it's just not gonna be good for your mental health. You already feel very much like you don't want to be there. I think it's also important to ask yourself, you know, is it the people that you're working with? Is it the culture? Is it your work environment. You just need to switch jobs and go into the same industry but a different job. You can switch jobs and try it out and see if that works better for you. But also, I think to what Mel was saying, you know, you have time in your day to also pursue maybe like a passion project or a side project and use that time to maybe try and build on that project. That's how, you know, our ABG podcast came to be, where we just built it on the side while working our normal job. If it does scare you to leave a secure job. So those are different, I guess, routes that you could take, but best of luck.
Simon, I want you to know that you are definitely not alone in this. I think it's actually really, really common, especially for like Asian American people, where we were given definitions of success all the way up through college and even getting the job. And then afterwards, kind of like, now what, right? So this is at a place where I wouldn't think of it as like you were pursuing values that were not your own, but now you're at a new stage where you have to kind of figure out what your next set of values are. So first of all, don't feel alone or lost. Like, that's really common. I definitely felt that when I graduated. There was this sinking moment, like, okay, now what? And I don't really feel fulfilled. And I think it takes a little bit of trial and error. Some things that we've talked about to try to better understand yourself are like exercises like journaling, having conversations with your friends, just thinking deeply about like what is important to you. And then you can like try different things. Like, I'm the kind of person that even if I think about it or I talk about it, I won't really know how much I care about something or how much I enjoy it until I try it and I do it. So whether that means if you don't want to switch a job, you could do like volunteer work. They do have things sometimes where it's like you can volunteer, consult, and provide business services to nonprofit organizations or things like that. That's a way to explore different like jobs without like making a change. Mm-hmm. But yeah, just be patient with yourself, take your time, and trust that you will find the next thing that is important to you.
And that concludes this episode of Dear ABG. If you guys have a question for us or want to leave a voicemail, you may do so in our link in the description box.
And if you haven't caught up on our latest episode, we do have a podcast called Asian Boss Girl. We are on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, all your podcasting platforms.
And we'll catch you guys same spot, same time next week.
Bye! Seriously? Alright, so for me, I don't know what I'm gonna say.
She says, hey girls! Okay. One more point. But also, hold on.